versions of all the containers, which I had done earlier today, so there's no updates.
So each of these startings is a different Docker?
Yeah. So you've got the DNS one, Apache. Actually, it uses the fast CGI engine with PHP, so there isn't a separate container.
Oh, okay.
And once it's all up and running, it gives you a nice little GUI that gives you all your statuses here. Everything's health is 100%. Once you've got virtual hosts defined, it'll list them here. I had done some testing at home, but I removed it all just to show it here. PHP my admin, pretty much all the database admin tools. Just a basic summary of what you've got with each of the databases. So really, adding a virtual host is really just a matter of, in the data directory, on www, you've got so the virtual host is set up, but what it works off is your host file, which is it's just looking for a local host entry for all your domain names, UCLUG.loc. View your Apache configuration with it.
So now, is this web page, is that a separate Docker from all the others?
This is the Apache. It's within the Apache Docker.
Oh, okay.
That this configuration lives.
Okay. So with this Devilbox interface that we're looking at, that's virtual host.
That's within, I think it lives within the bind container.
Oh, I see.
Just because that's the only, you can start just that one and you get this interface.
Minimal.
And then you've got your little hello world from what I echoed out. Let me see where. compressed directory to htdocs and then re-zipped it. And then that way, just dropping it in there, it brings it into the Apache container.
Because the Apache container is mounting that directory as a drive?
Yes. So I know one of the big things with Docker is you can have your development container and eventually migrate it to your production container. I really haven't played around with it enough to, I'm really just having full access to the data directory. I muck around with what I've got to do with my different websites and then just SCP up my files to my VPS with Linode when I've got a working version, because I've learned that working on a live website's not the thing to do. Whether it's your little own rinky-dinky website or Servosity's next door when I work for Servosity.
I don't always code when I do push to production. I don't always test my code, but when I do, it's in production.
Test. That's right.
So to get started with WordPress, you need a database.
The bane of all IT security people is in my app.
I can tell you what directory, but my way or my security way of doing that is putting it in a non-default directory and then putting Apache's digest authentication in front of it and then having a login. Then I think you put additional layers. It's sort of like guessing a password before you try to hack it, because you have to know what the hell the directory is and then you have to know the password to get past that.
I use Webmin a lot. The advantage of it is it runs on a separate port, so you can just ACL it off to just your IP address.
I did, actually George turned me on the Webmin years ago, and I found that you could use SSH proxy, basically bind the local port to the remote port,
yeah.
And you can visit like, you know, a custom URL in your browser. I actually wrote a little script when I alias, when I type like Webmin client name, it opens a Chrome browser with that URL with that specific port, and then I just hit refresh and it like comes up. That's a pretty damn screwy way to do it. I suppose you could do that with PHP MyAdmin or something like that. Put it on a different port.
It's really sucks, like, you know, you're trying to learn all this crap.
Or is Devilbox versus something like Webmin or Virtualmin? Is it just kind of tight Docker integration that makes you use it? Versus a different solution?
It was, I saw it on a post on Reddit, and it was something, what I've got on my main machine at home, serving my different media out to my TV. I didn't want to break anything for my wife. So it was easier to segregate it and do what I had to do and not worry about breaking things. So I went back, I deleted the database I had created, because this lets you create it all. Password is extremely weak. But you can serve, is accessible through their names, so PHP, to get to the MySQL container, you just give it the host name of MySQL. And then, and then install WordPress, and you've got WordPress running in your container. And then back into PHP My Admin, you can control your database to export it if you've got your production that you want to go live with. There was another CMS I downloaded just to show Wonder CMS, which is basically just a there's no scripting involved, there's no database involved. So we do give Jace the website. Wonder CMS.
Or Wunder.
You just like generate static files in the CMS, that's what I just need a database.
Most small sites don't need a database.
Yeah, because you don't have 10 million WordPress objects, it's probably lots of wood.
So just the makdir and the unzip there adds it in as a virtual host.
That certainly is easier than WordPress.
That's good. Yeah. Like,
and you don't even need a username, you just
have a generator to build all your web pages and serve your cache. Kids are doing it.
George, you've got all kinds of nuggets.
Why does WordPress do that?
WordPress can do dynamic stuff. It'd be easy to pretty much have templates. You might do a blog or a marketing site, but you have little dynamic pieces that have to be tied to.
And this one is really simple. It's just adding a...
You can't have anything that's PHP or dynamic script.
It just looks great.
You just have static pages. Which, if you had a blog or really basic website, caching in front of the web server, and you have some sort of cache static files anyway.
Sorry.
Has its place. I'm thinking about doing some like.
So that's. I mean, I was looking for. I know one of the other meetings, somebody had asked about that type of thing where it was just, how can I build a basic website without really any programming? I think it was the older guy that did the robot.
questions?
How does this compare with what Webmin does for you? It seemed like it's less, but is it sort of a basic replacement for Webmin with containers?
Does Webmin do containers?
No, Webmin's more sysadmin.
Or like VirtualMin, I guess would be.
VirtualMin is more of a virtual web hosting part of it. It's along the lines of CentOS web panel that I showed there. This is really more development based than really sysadmin.
It looks like if you want to do containers, this would be a better way than, you know, like Webmin. But to me, you know, if you're already comfortable with Webmin, diving into the containers is just stay out of it.
So, question, if you want to do any CLI stuff, you know, like do a dump of MySQL, do you do it for the interface there? Or are
you can do it.
Docker CLI.
You can do it both. You can do it through you can grab your database and just do export and it'll dump it out to a file. If you wanted to, there's a shell that lets you get into one of the containers and
that's hooked up through Docker Compose.
It's the version I've got on my machine at home. This was the only way. It actually didn't come with all of the admin tools, so it's literally you drop your dump file into the shared directory and get into MySQL. Source on your .sql file to load it into the database. But the web-based stuff is, I haven't updated my other machine at home, but I fought with doing the database load this way for quite a while, and the PHP my admin is much easier.
Would you mind going back to your shell and showing us this command that exits in there and exits that? And show us.
Did George?
Yeah. I didn't hear you, Ben. Are you guys feeling like we felt last month? Have you been able to view all this, or has it streamed okay for you? Any questions from anybody there?
I
George, appreciate that.